suppose you're thinking I was lost there. We're going to join together, sing a few choruses. Be up on the screen in a moment. The first one is Jesus' name above all names. Beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer, living Word. We'll sing this through twice. Thank you. Next course is reach out and touch the Lord as he goes by. And that's our wish, that people will indeed reach out and touch the Lord. Just as the lady with the issue touched the Lord's garment and she was healed, all we have to do is reach out to the Lord. And we who are not saved, those who are not saved, will be healed. Reach out and touch the Lord. Well, thank you. Then the final one, I will sing on to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God. Thank you. These are good singers from Ballyclare Baptist Church tonight. Thanks very much for singing so well. Now we're going to stand and start the service off with the hymn, There Is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's Own Son. Sing it out well. Thank you. Our own brother Stephen Blair is going to come and lead us in prayer before the Lord tonight. Thank you, Stephen.
Okay, folks, we'll just open a wee word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you again this evening, and again we come before you with praise in our lips, Heavenly Father, and thankfulness in our hearts. Just thank you, Heavenly Father, we come before you again this evening, a God who is indeed in control of all things, Heavenly Father, a God who is almighty, a God who never changes, one who has made the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we just thank you again, and come even and sing praises to you this evening. We've been singing about Jesus, our Redeemer, Heavenly Father. And we thank you for those here this evening, Heavenly Father, who've known and have trusted the Savior, Heavenly Father. We thank you for a Savior who was willing to leave the splendor and glory of heaven and come to this earth and go all the way there to the cross and pay the price for our sin in full. We thank you for that finished work and for our risen Savior. And we just pray for this meeting here this evening, Heavenly Father. We just pray for each person gathered. For those that know and love you, we just, again, our hearts are filled with joy when we think of what you've done for us, Heavenly Father. When we think of our salvation, we just pray for any in our gathering this evening or anyone listening in, even online, who yet doesn't know the Savior, that even tonight would be the night they come and put their faith and trust in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we're reading your word that indeed all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But we also read that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And if there's anyone here this evening, Heavenly Father, who yet hasn't had that problem of sin dealt with, we just pray that tonight would be the night, Heavenly Father, that they come and trust the Savior. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing our brother David here amongst us again this evening. We thank you for the time this morning around your word and the time around the table and for help given. But again, we just pray this evening you would take him up and use him and speak through him in a mighty way. We just pray you would know the help and the leading and the liberty of the Holy Spirit as he would just share again this evening what you've led in his heart. Would you pray for our own pastor, David, this evening too, and as he would share the message of the gospel, and would you pray for other such gatherings up and down our land where the message of the gospel is being preached. Would you just pray that even this evening we'd be hearing of men and women and boys and girls putting their faith and trust in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we just think of those who would love to be out with us tonight, but they're not able to be here. We think of those who are maybe not so well at this time. We think of those who are on in years. And we just pray that even in their own homes this evening, you would draw especially near to them. And even at this time, just be all to them that they need. just think of those who've even been bereaved, Heavenly Father, even in the week gone by. We continue to think of the Allen family, and we just leave them in your hands and in your care, and just pray you would just be all to them that they need at this time as well. So Heavenly Father, again, we just give you thanks for your goodness to us, Heavenly Father, and we just pray that this evening everything that's said and everything that's done would indeed bring glory to you. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Stephen. Now we're going to turn to God's Word. If you'd like to turn to Luke chapter 15. Reading together, Luke chapter 15. Reading from verse 11 to the end. And he said, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked him what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out, and entreated him. And he answering and said to his father, lo, these many years I did serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Amen. We know the Lord will bless the reading of his word to us. A very warm welcome to everybody tonight into Ballyclare Baptist Church. And any visitors with us, you're more than welcome. It's lovely to welcome our brother David with us. He's very welcome to us. Enjoyed his ministry this morning. Looking forward to what the Lord has laid upon his heart. And his dear wife is with him too. You're very welcome. And Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. is prayer and Bible study, and that will be taken with our own pastor, David Cosby. Friday at 6:30 is the Youth Fellowship and the Kids Zone. And as I mentioned each week, these two works are wonderful. They're great with the children. It's lovely to see so many children coming in. And also to the Sunday school, so many new faces. The Lord's reaching out. The Lord's touching these children. Please pray much for this work, that each week children will indeed hear the gospel and children will indeed be saved and changed. Next, Lord's Day, our own Pastor David will be speaking at both services. Now, there'll be a church choir practice for Christmas after next week's evening service. Remember, no practice tonight. All are welcome to join and make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And then we plan to give out calendars around the houses and also some shortbread. If you would like to help with the cost of the shortbread, you can drop money in the box just sitting at the back. Also, if you'd like to help with the delivery, please speak with Stephen or the pastor. Many thanks. Please remember all the missions we support from the church, especially our own brother Stephen working with Shining Lights. And remember all those who are unwell at this time and those waiting for hospital treatment. Now, all these announcements are made in the will of the Lord. Now, before our brother comes and speaks to us tonight, we're going to join together and singing again. Beneath the cross of Jesus, I find a place to stand and wonder at such mercy that calls me as I am. Stanley to sing. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for those words of welcome. It's good to be back with you again this evening. I feel very much at home with you, having fellowship with you, and thank you for your prayers also. Luke 15 is a very familiar passage to all of us, I'm sure. I'm going to title this message, Come Home, Come Home. It's a well-known parable. I'm sure many of us have heard it for many years. And as people say, what is a parable? Some people say it's an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And our Lord used quite a number of them when he was instructing people during his time on earth. I think one of the reasons why our Lord did that is because people do remember stories. We're very good at remembering stories that people tell us, and the Lord used that. Secondly, sometimes the Lord would put the truth in a parable so that they wouldn't find something to accuse him of, because there were those who wanted to arrest Jesus, who wanted to try him, who weren't pleased with his ministry, and they were looking for a way to trap him. And so sometimes the Lord used parables just to hide the truth from those who didn't believe, but for those who believed, then their eyes were open to what Jesus was teaching. Now, how are we supposed to handle parables? Well, a parable often is a story, a general story about some persons, and they're meant to represent various things. So when you think of the parable of the sower, for example, in Mark 4:13, we see that Jesus shows us that within that parable, different people, different things in the parable are meant to convey something to us. So we think of them as allegories, and we should approach them that way, looking for the metaphors that are there in the parables. Now, there's a limit to how many things we can take from a parable, and some people suggested, well, maybe a parable should just have one main central truth. That may be true for many parables, but often in parables, there can be more than one principle that we get from the parable and then multiple applications. Craig Blomberg says that some of the parables in his book, Interpreting the Parables, do have more than one lesson for us to learn. And how are we going to get how many lessons we should get from this parable? Well, Craig Blomberg suggests, depending on the number of principal characters there are in a parable, that should point to the number of principles that we should get from that parable. So as we have had the parable so well read for us by our brother, we realize there are three principal characters in the parable. We have the father, we have the younger son, and we have the older son. So there are three main characters, as it were, in the parable. Yes, there are other people there, but they are like extras that are required for the story to work. So what we're going to do is we're going to just go through the parable verse by verse and make some comments on the way through, and then we'll think about how we can interpret this parable, bearing in mind what Blomberg is suggesting, that there should be three principles that we can draw from that, and then from there we will see how it applies to us. So let's turn, please, to Luke 15 and look at these verses again. Now, Luke 15, if you go back to the beginning of the chapter, look at verses 1 and 2. It says, "Then drew near unto him," this is Jesus, "all the publicans and sinners, for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners, and eateth with them. Verse 3, "And he spake this parable unto them, saying." Now, as we go through Luke 15, you'll see there are actually three parables here. The first one is the sheep, the 100 sheep. One of those sheep was lost and was found. Then there's the parable of the coins. The lady had the 10 coins. One of those was lost and was found. And in each case, there was rejoicing when that which was lost was found. But the longest parable in the chapter is the one we've just looked at. So here we see there's a younger son of this gentleman in verse 12. And he says to his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me." Now, what really is he saying? In the Old Testament covenant, if you were a eldest son, you would have had twice the inheritance of the other siblings. So that double portion was for the oldest child. He would have inherited the business of his father, the land of his father, and so on. And he would have had a double portion. The rest of the children would have had a single portion. So in this case, you have two sons. So the older child would expect to receive 2/3 of the estate when his father would pass on, and the younger son would expect to receive the remaining 1/3. What this really means is that the younger son is saying, look, Dad, I know that when you've passed on, this is what's going to happen. My older brother's going to get 2/3 of the estate, whatever it was, and I'm going to get 1/3. I want it now. I don't want to wait until you've passed on. I wish you were gone, and then I could have it immediately, but since you're still here, I want it now. I want it now. I know it's my inheritance, and give it to me. I don't know, those of you who are parents, how would you feel if your son came to you and said, look, I want my inheritance now, I don't want to wait until you've gone, just give it to me now. I think you wouldn't be particularly pleased with that person. But the parable doesn't say anything about that. It just says he divided unto them his living. Now, if you think about that, that's going to be rather difficult to do. Those who are farmers, you have property, you have land, you have livestock. If suddenly your son says he wants 1/3, of what that is going to affect you, isn't it? You're going to have to sell things, you're going to have to sell livestock, you're going to have to sell land, you're going to have to divide it up and so on. So I'm sure he wasn't too pleased with this decision. Of course, the older brother wouldn't be happy either. This is going to affect everybody. It's going to affect the entire family, what he's asking for. Yet, it's just said here that the father agrees to do this. So he decides to do that. But I think if it was one of us, we wouldn't be very happy if someone were to come along and say, look, I want my inheritance now, I don't want to wait, I want it immediately. And I suppose in our country, sometimes if maybe someone is a farmer, maybe has a farm of land, and he has several sons, I suppose the pattern would be that he would hope that one of those sons would take over the farm, and presumably there would be that plan that he would take over the business, as it were, after his father would pass on, and maybe other children in the family would get maybe some cash or some funds to help them start a business or maybe give them a plot of land or something. there would be other things which he would do, but there'd be that one who would take over the farm. So this younger son is going against what would be normal. This younger son is going to affect everybody in the family. Anyway, the father agrees to give it to him, and then not many days later, verse 13, he gathers what is his, and he goes off, he clears off. He wants to be as far away as possible from any parental influence, from anybody asking him what he's doing. He wants to live his own life. He wants to be independent. And so he takes the money with him. And as he goes into this far country, we see that as long as he has the money, I'm sure he had plenty of friends, but it says he wasted it. He wasted it in riotous living. So here we have this younger son. He's gone off. He's squandered his wealth. Actually, the word prodigal means liberal or generous, and in the original sense. So he's called the prodigal son because he was just throwing his money around and enjoying himself, of course, until it ran out. And then when it runs out, then I'm sure his friends vanished because there's no longer going to be any blessing or any benefit from being near him. So when he'd spent everything he had, verse 14, then to make it even worse, there was a famine in the land. So here he finds himself in a distant land, penniless, and there's a famine, and he is in want, verse 14. So he joins himself to a citizen of the country, verse 15, and that man sent him out into the fields to feed swine. Now you know that in the Old Testament, pigs were unclean animals. Jews were to have nothing to do with them. And here we have a Jewish person who's having to look after pigs. In fact, he would even have eaten the food that was being given to the pigs in verse 16. He would have eaten those, but even that was denied him. So this younger son, he's gone, he's wasted his substance. Now he finds himself right at rock bottom. Verse 17, we see now a change in his heart. He came to himself. He looked around. He said, well, how many servants does my father have? And they're not suffering in the way that I am, even though I'm a son. I'm perishing with hunger. Verse 18, I will rise and go to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee. Isn't that amazing? He's realized his need. He's realized that he doesn't have anything to help him. He came to his senses. He is repentant. He wants to turn away from that way of life. He realized that what he's done, he's sinned against God. And ultimately, every sin you and I commit, it's against God. It may be against other people as well, but it's ultimately against God. And the psalmist knew this in Psalm 51, verse 4. You know, you and I, we're not independent. We're not autonomous. We can't just live our life any way we like. Sometimes we like to think that we are. We like to think we're the master of our own fate, as it were. But if you think about it, we're very dependent upon other people. Take, for example, when you sit down and you eat a meal. Ask yourself, could you have prepared this meal? Could you have grown the ingredients? Could you have sourced the ingredients for this meal yourself? If you had the land to grow them, how much land would you need in order to grow how much food you're going to eat for a whole year? And then how are you going to cook that food? Where are you going to get the fuel to burn to cook that food? We are completely dependent upon so many people, hundreds of other people, in order to maintain our way of life. It's just an illusion, a myth, that we're autonomous. Actually, we're extremely dependent. The scriptures say every good thing we enjoy in life, it has come down from the Father, from God himself. He is the one who's kind to the unthankful and to the evil. So it's just an illusion if we think that we're able to defend for ourselves and we're able to supply everything we need. So this young man realizes that he himself has made a mistake here. He's gone wrong. He's gone the wrong way. He has squandered his living. He has done what was not expected of him. And we find that his way of life was just one that he realized he has to turn from that way of life. That's what repentance means. It means to turn, to do an about turn. He realized he has to go home and just be humble. Humble himself before the Father and say, look, I've sinned against you and I've sinned against God. Just let me come and dwell in the house as a servant. I'll be a servant. I'll just serve, and whatever you want to give me as a servant, that is fine. And so he comes to his senses and he decides to go back. And he says, look, he even rehearses what he's going to say. Look, I'm going to say to my father, I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. So we see in verse 20, here he is. He's going back again home. But while he was a great way away, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. That would be like the greeting of the Middle East in those days. And so this father runs out and embraces him. I wonder if the father was looking out for him. Maybe every day he was looking at the horizon, looking down the road to see if there was any sign of his son coming back. And I'm sure he was praying for him. I'm sure he was waiting for that son to come back, just longing for him to come home again, come to his senses and come home. So when he sees him coming, the son hasn't said anything yet. The father runs after him. Now, where Debbie and I worked in Nigeria, you don't run. Something is wrong with you if you run, especially if you're an older person. You're not supposed to run. That's very undignified for you to begin running. So this man doesn't care. He doesn't mind being undignified because it's his son, and he loves him, and he's running out to meet him. The only time you run where we were in Nigeria is when there's a problem. I remember one time, one of the dorms at the seminary where we were working, it caught fire. And that was the time I saw people really run. Some people really ran with buckets of water and things to put that fire out before it would catch hold. The only other time I saw people run so hard was when we were under the possibility of an attack, and then people were running. So those are the times people would run. But here he is, this man runs out to welcome his son. So he's so pleased to see him come back. So look at verse 22. The father said to his servants, bring the best robe, put it on him, put a ring in his hand, shoes in his feet. He's meeting the immediate needs of his child. Shoes, something to wear. And then he says in verse 23, bring thither the fatted calf, that we may kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. And they began to be merry. So the father is so excited to see him back and so welcoming that even before the son says anything, this is what he's already decided to do. This is what he's asking the servants to do. So here he is. He is accepting the son back again. And they're going to have a party. Everybody's going to enjoy the fact that he's come back. There's going to be a feast. There's going to be singing. There's going to be laughter. There's going to be dancing. The whole household is going to rejoice. But the story doesn't stop there. If it was just a story about that son, that prodigal son, the word prodigal now has a negative connotation. If it was only about that prodigal son, then the parable could have stopped at this point, but it doesn't. It keeps going. There's still quite a bit to go from verse 25 on. So the elder son was out in the field. Here he is. He's working away. As he came back to the house, he drew near to the house. He heard music and dancing. And he calls one of the servants and asks, what's going on? Verse 27. And they say, your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he's received him safe and sound. And what was the reaction of the older brother? He was angry, and he wouldn't go in. Why was he angry? Why was he angry? He was angry and wouldn't go in. We'll come back to that in a minute. So when the father hears about this, presumably the servant went and told him, look, the older brother's out there. He's angry. He doesn't want to come in. The father decides to go out. I like this father. He's so kind. He's so gentle with his children. So he goes out to try and reason, try to beg his son to come into the house. And so he was angry and wouldn't go in. His father goes out and entreats him, basically begs him to come in. So what does the older brother say? Verse 29. He answered and said unto his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never givest me a kid that I make merry with my friends. Look at what he's saying here. He's saying, okay, look, I've been serving you. I've never disobeyed you. It's hard to believe that was the absolute truth. But you know when you're angry, sometimes you exaggerate. And I think this is what he was doing. And I never transgressed your commandment. And then he begins to accuse his father of ingratitude. He says, look, you never let me have a kid, even just a kid that I can make merry with my friends. So he's even accusing his father of injustice, of doing something wrong in welcoming this brother back. And notice the way the pronouns are used. Verse 30, but as soon as this thy son was come, he won't even say my brother. Probably he was quite happy to see him go. Probably when he saw this guy go, he thought, well, that's great. He's a waster. Good riddance. Probably happy to see him go. So now he's come back. He won't even admit his brother. He says, this your son. And you know, sometimes that happens in families, doesn't it? That when maybe a child is wayward, maybe a son is wayward, and the mother may say, that son of yours, this is what he's done, or vice versa. You know, sometimes we disown the relationships when we're angry with one another. And this is what this boy is doing. He said, thy son, your son, nothing to do with me. He's not my brother, he's your son. And then the father says, look, son, just reminding him that he's still his son as well, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. I wonder if that was part of the problem. Maybe the older brother thought, here's this waster, and he's come back again. And now he's already squandered a third of the property. Maybe he's going to come and waste more, and he's going to cause trouble in the home, and I'm going to have to share something with him because everything actually should be mine because I'm the one who's supposed to take over. I think the father realizes this. He says, look, all that I have is thine. Don't be worried about that. You still have your inheritance. But it was right, it was good, it was meet that we should make merry and be glad for this thy brother, reminding him that this is his brother, not just his son. Thy brother was dead and he's alive again. He was lost and is found. And so how did the brother know so much about the son? He says, look, this son, he has devoured your living with harlots. How did he know that? I mean, there's no internet in those days. There's no telephones, no social media systems. How would he know what the younger brother was doing? This is slander. This is an assumption on his part. Well, maybe he knew the character of his brother. Maybe he reckoned that this is the way his brother would spend the money and so on. Maybe that's what he was basing it on. But nevertheless, you can see that he's not at all happy that this brother has come home. Okay, now let's think about the interpretation then. What is the context? Whenever you read anything in Scripture, you've got to think of the context. We had the context earlier, remember, when we looked at the beginning of the chapter, verse 15, verses 1 and 2. Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. Here are people who are coming to Jesus. They realize something is not right in their lives and that Jesus has the answer. And these people heard Jesus gladly. They're so pleased to be where he was because they knew he spoke the truth and they knew he had the answer to their problems. And so they were coming to Jesus wanting to know more about him. But the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. To them, they were the righteous ones. And these other people, they were the lowlife of the society of the time. These were the tax collectors. These were the sinners. These were the people that they wouldn't have anything to do with. Why is Jesus even meeting with them? Why is he spending any time with them? Doesn't he know that they're unrighteous? Doesn't he know that they're unclean? Doesn't he know that they're not following the laws of God, that they're breaking the laws of God? And that's why Jesus gave the parables. So we must think of the context then. We have the context of Jesus and the sinners and those that are outcasts in the society. They're coming to him. But the religious leaders of the day, those who thought that they were following the law of God, those who taught people the law itself, the scribes and the Pharisees, who were serious about trying to keep the Ten Commandments and all the other commandments that they'd made to surround those commandments so people would never break them. Here they're unhappy with what Jesus is doing. And so we see that the context is one of Jesus, the sinners, and the self-righteous who are there. So what then do these three persons represent in the parable? Well, the lost son, he pictures those sinners who need to repent. They realize that they're in need. They realize that something is wrong. And they realize that the only solution is to come back in humility to the Lord himself. And you know, sometimes this is true, that people sometimes realize that they are sinners in the sight of God. I heard about some ladies that were trying to help people that would be coming out of the bars and the clubs in a major town in Northern Ireland at night. And you know, some of these people, they're drunk and they can't even walk properly. And they try to help them, try to maybe get them something to drink, some coffee or something, try and get them sobered up, try and get them home again. And one of those ladies said, what are good people like you doing with trash like me? So there are some people who realize that they're lost, who realize that they're far from the home of God. There are those who realize that they need a Savior. And perhaps there's someone like that in the meeting. Maybe you know your life is not right before God. Maybe you realize that your life is so far away from what is pleasing to God. You know that you're a sinner in the sight of God. Well, then the younger son is telling you that, yes, Jesus loves such a person. And so when we think of this younger son, we see that no matter how sinful a person is, that person can come to God. No matter what a person has done, whatever it is, it can be forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ. If that person is ready to humble themselves, if that person is ready to repent and come back to God and approach Jesus Christ, he will receive them. Is there anybody like that here? Maybe you realize you're a sinner in the sight of God because the Scripture says all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. You know, there's none righteous, no, not one. Maybe you're like that in the meeting. Are you troubled by some guilt, some sin in your life? And you know it's not right. You know it's contrary to the law of God. Maybe you've lost your way in life. Perhaps you know what you're supposed to do, but you've taken a wrong turn, and now you find yourself very far from the things of God. Yet you've come here to this service. You're listening to this message. Then, like the younger son, the message that's come to you is that no matter what you've done, God is ready to forgive you. God is ready to receive you. Jesus Christ invites you to come to him, and he will take that burden away, and he will give you peace with God. He will remove that guilt. He will remove that sense of evil in your life, and he will start you on a new life that only Jesus Christ can do. So the younger son then is telling us that no matter what we've done, there is that possibility of coming back to the Father, just like those people in the very early part of the chapter. What about the older son? Well, the older son never really went far from home. He was working for his father, as he said. Well, was he really working for his father, or was he working for himself because everything was now his? You can go and think about that one. But his heart wasn't right with God. He thought he was okay. He thought he was righteous. He thought that he was one of the righteous people. Compared to his brother, he thought that he was the one who was righteous. But this story shows that he too is lost. It's not just the younger son that's lost. I know we call it the parable of the lost son, but I think we should really call it the parable of the lost sons, because he too is outside the home. He is outside the place of blessing. He isn't where the Father wants him to be. And there are people like that, people who think that they're okay. And in Northern Ireland, there are many people like that. They're good people. They're moral people. Yeah, they're not perfect, but they'll say nobody's perfect. But if you look at them, you say, well, that's a good living person, or he's a good man, or that's a good woman. And they would think, well, that person's okay. Well, it's like that, isn't it? Every now and then you meet someone and you try to explain to them the need of Christ, the Savior, and they say, well, I go to my church, I keep the commandments, I'm not a bad person, I haven't done anything really wrong in my life, I'm a moral person, and I think I have a pretty good chance of getting into heaven. And that idea seems to be so common in our society. In fact, some people think it's automatic, that as soon as you die, you automatically go to heaven. Isn't this what happens when someone is tragically maybe murdered on the streets, and they'll put some flowers there, and they'll put maybe little cards and maybe other little notes and things, and they'll say that they're in heaven looking down, that they've gone to heaven and they're looking down on us. On what basis do people make that assumption? Because that's what it is. Because unless a person has the Lord Jesus Christ, unless a person is saved, they're not going to heaven. And so there are those who are self-righteous. They think they're okay, like the older brother, that they're the ones who know God, that they're the ones who are okay before God. But we can see the older brother is not okay with God. Did he go in? If you notice at the end of the parable, Jesus doesn't say whether he went in or not. It's sort of left hanging. The father is inviting him to come in, but we don't know whether he did or not. So the older brother represents the Pharisees, the scribes and the Pharisees. They thought they were okay. But Jesus is saying, no, your very reaction to what's happening, these people who want to hear Jesus gladly, shows that you don't know who Jesus is. You don't know what the gospel is. You don't know your need of Christ. And this is part of the problem, that some people don't realize that everyone before God is a sinner until that person is saved. Everyone needs to be born again. It's not an option. You must be born again. So maybe you're like the older brother. I think sometimes in our churches we have people who grew up in our churches and they're good people. People think they're fine. People think they're saved. People think they're Christians, quite all right. And I'm thinking of a gentleman right now, and people thought that of him. He was going to a church in Cookstown, a different denomination from the ones we're familiar with. But he was going there, and everybody thought he was Christian. And then they had a course within the church, and he came to realize that he wasn't a believer. He had heard the gospel, he knew what the gospel was, but he hadn't made it his own. And he came to Christ, and he gave his testimony, and people were surprised. They thought, what? Well, we thought you were a Christian because of the way you lived. He said, no, I never really was. Where I was in Jos, Nigeria, there was a guy called Emmanuel Abba. Nigerians call their children all kinds of interesting names. But anyway, his name was Emmanuel. And Emmanuel gave his testimony that when he was growing up in the village, he liked going to church. His mother wanted him to be a pastor. And so Emmanuel thought, okay, that's what my mother wants me to be. I like going to church. So he went to church and got involved in church. And he eventually became a pastor. And he was a pastor in that village and in a denomination in Nigeria, not the one we were working with, another one. And there he was. He was a pastor in this village in a church. And then they decided to have a mission in the village. And the people who were conducting the mission, you know, the way people sometimes have missions here as well, they decided, well, let's involve the local churches in this village in the mission. And so they gathered all the pastors together and said, look, we want to have a mission, gospel mission, in this village, and we want you to be with us and be supporting the mission in the village. And as they were discussing what they were going to do in the mission, someone said, how can we talk about having a mission in this village when there's a dead person in our midst? And they were talking about Emmanuel. And Emmanuel said, what? You're calling me a dead person? Don't you know I'm a pastor? Don't you know that I preach the gospel? Don't you know that I preach the gospel and people are getting saved? And then he realized he himself wasn't saved. So here he was a pastor. He was preaching the gospel, but it wasn't his own. And I wonder if there's people like that in our churches. They grow up in the church. They think they're okay. They grow up in a church in Northern Ireland. They think they're okay. They stay in the church all their life. But when it comes to that judgment time, Christ will say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you that work iniquity. And that's one of those frightening things, that someone can be so close. This older brother was right there close to the father. He was in his home. He was in the house. He was working for him. It wasn't like the younger brother, it appears, in terms of his conduct, but he wasn't saved. Like the Pharisees and the scribes, they were trying to follow the law of God, but they didn't believe in Jesus. They didn't realize who he was. They didn't see their need of him. They thought that they could see, but they were actually blind. The blind leading the blind. And Jesus said, that's what's wrong with them. They couldn't see that they couldn't see. They didn't realize that they couldn't see the truth. He is the Savior. And until they would believe in him, they would never be saved. No matter how good they were, because we can never be good enough. We can't reach God's mark. We always fall short of the standard. And so that older brother represents the scribes and the Pharisees. They too need to come to Jesus. They too need to come home. Did the older brother go in? Story doesn't say. But at least they had all the blessings of the law and the prophets, just as some people have the blessings of church and knowing what the gospel is, but they haven't made it their own. And until they make it their own, they are still lost. Their hearts are not right. I hope there's nobody like that here this evening. Maybe you've been in this church for a long time, but you've never actually accepted Jesus as Savior. You have never surrendered to him, never bowed the knee and repented of your sin. Well, salvation is not of works. That's what the scripture says. It's by grace. It's something we receive. It's not of works so that no man can boast. It's not by works of righteousness which we have done. It's something that God offers to us. If we repent and come to him, then we will see how the Lord will forgive us. And then the third person in the story, of course, is the father. The father, as we said, this man, he seems to me to be a very gentle person in the way that he handles both of his sons. The younger son looking for his inheritance in advance, and the older son going out and entreating him to come in. And of course, the father represents God himself. That God is someone who is ready to receive any who come to him. He is the one who loves us and cares for us. And he delights to see the son come back from the far country. But he also delights to see the older son come to a knowledge of who he is and of the salvation that is offered. You know, maybe some people in the meeting, maybe you've not gone deeply into sin. Maybe you can't say that you've really gone that far from the church. You've had many privileges. You've had that Christian blessing and background, but you've not made it your own. You have to make it your own. I grew up in a Christian home. My parents sent me to Sunday school faithfully, and I realized, even though they were Christians, that didn't make me one. I had to receive Jesus for myself. And so it is with us. The Father shows us that God is so willing to forgive anyone who repents. You see, he loves both of his sons. He loves that wayward one that went off to the far country, but he also loves the older one that's right nearby him. And he wants both of them to come in. He wants them to come home. He wants them to come and enjoy that blessing of being with him and rejoicing in that salvation that's available. C.S. Lewis, you know, is a very famous, very intellectual person, and he wrote a book about his own salvation called Surprised by Joy. because he said he became a Christian reluctantly, but when he became a Christian, he was surprised that it was actually something to enjoy, something that he would enjoy in life. And so it is. The father is inviting both children in to the joy that there is in salvation. The love is there for them both. How do we know that God loves us? Well, God loves us because he sent Jesus Christ to die for us. Every time we think of Jesus Christ on the cross, we see the love of God, that he was willing to give his son, and the love of the son, because the son was willing to come and die for us, because we couldn't save ourselves. But he demonstrates his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so we see in the Father the story of God who loves us. Whether we be self-righteous or whether we're aware of how sinful we are all loved by God. And so it is. All of us need to come home. We need to come into the presence of God. What is it that makes heaven heaven? I know we see the picture of heaven as a place where the streets are paved with gold. We see it as a place where there's all kinds of beautiful colors and precious jewels and things there and the representation of heaven. But is that what makes heaven heaven? Because really in the end, we are going to be joint heirs with Christ. We will all own everything with him. The rewards that we have, we will give them back to him. We will restore the crowns to him. What is it that makes heaven heaven? It's the presence of the Father. The fact that we're at home, that we will have that fullness of joy, as it talks about in Psalm 16:11. The psalmist said, "There's none on earth that I desire beside thee." I don't know if you remember back when you were a child, maybe you're going home from school, it's one of those wet, wintry nights, and you're on your way, you're tramping home, and you're looking forward to being home. What is it that makes home home? Well, maybe it's the fact you're going to be warm because it's cold as you're walking through the rain and maybe through the snow, and you realize that when you get home, it's going to be warm. You're going to be in the living room, a familiar place. You're going to have the comfort maybe of a favorite sofa or chair in there. Hopefully, you're going to get a good meal to eat later on that evening. Well, all of these things are things that make home home, but really, it goes deeper than that. Home is the place where you are accepted. Home is the place where you really belong. Home is the place where you are deeply loved and you can love in return. That's what God is inviting us to. He's inviting us to come and enjoy his presence forever. Be done with those things which masquerade as gods. Be done with those things that distract us from the one true one we should be interested in, that is the Lord himself. And that is where we truly belong. He made us. We are created to worship him. And when we do, then we will know who we are. And we will enjoy the life that God has given us. So as we look at the parable of the lost son, I think it should really be called the parable of the lost sons. That both of them need to come home. And God is inviting you to come home. Come home to him. Well, let's think of some applications of this parable then. First of all, maybe you're a parent. Maybe your child has wandered far from the fold. Maybe they're off in a far country, either physically or mentally, they have departed from you. Don't give up. Don't stop praying for them. Don't stop looking out for them. The father in the story, I believe, hadn't forgotten his son. And if that son comes back, receive them back into the home. Where we worked in Gogoro, it's actually the tradition of the people. Some of the tribes in Nigeria, they had some really moral teaching within those tribes, even before Christianity came along. And there was a family there, and they told us that in the traditional Kogoro culture, if a young lady got pregnant before she was married, that child would be ostracized. That child would be banned, as it were, from the family. She would be cast out from the family. And there was one Christian family at Kogoro, and this is what happened. One of their daughters, the daughter went off to university, and while she was there, she got pregnant and had a child. And technically, in the local culture, they're supposed to abandon her. But because they were Christians, they welcomed her back. They took her back into their home, and they cared for her, and they also cared for the child. Maybe you're like the younger son. You know in your heart that you're not right before God. Maybe you haven't gone off far away from home, as it were. Maybe you haven't gone far from the church physically, but in your heart of hearts, you're in the far country. You know you're far away from God. You know your heart isn't right with God. God is saying, come home. He's ready to receive you, waiting to receive you. He loves you. and he wants you to be home. Are you like that older son? Maybe everybody thinks you're okay, you're a Christian, you're good living, you're a moral person. But you don't rejoice when the lost are found. And you don't know what it means to really be a child of God. Yes, you may be faithfully attending the church, maybe even active in the church, like my brother Emmanuel, who came to realization that he wasn't a Christian. And yet, he did come to know Christ. You're a stranger to grace. Come home to the Father. Just one more story from Nigeria, where we were at Kogoro. There were a couple of students, and one of our fellow lecturers, one of the Nigerian lecturers in this case, he was teaching a class, and he was teaching the class about the gospel. He was explaining to people what the gospel was, and a couple of the students in the class realized that they weren't saved. So they were in a theological seminary. They had grown up in church. They were actually involved in the church. They were in the diaconate of that church. They had gone to a theological college and gone through theological college. Now they were at the seminary. They were going through the seminary, and they realized they weren't saved. And by the grace of God, they came to know Christ in the seminary. So they were really there to train people how to be pastors and Bible teachers. While some of we were there, they came to faith in Christ. Can you look back to a time when you surrendered to Christ, when you made him Lord? If you can't do that, then are you really saved? You may be a good person, a moral person, but everyone must be born again. God, your Father, loves you. He's waiting for you to welcome you into his home. Repent and turn, because he is there, ready to receive you if you will trust in what Christ has done for you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the love that you have for every one of us. We realize that Christ died for all. But realize also, Lord, there are those who don't understand that they cannot earn their own salvation. Some don't realize they need salvation. And Father, we pray that any who are listening to this, who are represented by either the younger son who knows that they're very far from you, who knows that their life is much less than it should be, who realize that they're sinners before you and even in their own sight, Lord, we pray that they would come home to Christ. They would recognize Jesus died for them so that they can be set free from that way of life. And for others, Lord, who maybe haven't gone off into those avenues of sin, but yet they're not right before you, Lord, we pray that they too would realize that it's not enough to be a good person. It's not enough to try and do one's best, but a person needs to accept Jesus Christ as Savior. Lord, we pray that they too would humble themselves and be ready to come home, because we know, Lord, that you love them, that your Son died for them, and the offer of salvation is freely given to them. Lord, give them that wisdom to make that decision tonight, not to put it off, because now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. And we ask these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's rise and sing in closing, please. Our closing hymn, Nearer, Still Nearer, Close to Thy Heart. Lord, do the work that only you can. Draw people to yourself. May they realize their need of Christ as Savior. May they take that step of faith. Even now we pray, and we ask it for your glory and for your name's sake. Amen.